Hello, this is RollingStone.com, and I'm Jackson Brown talking about my new CD, Time the Conqueror. And Giving That Heaven Away. Well, Giving That Heaven Away, this is one of my favorite songs. This is a piece of music I had, like just a melody I had for a long time. And it was about somebody that I had a really blinding sexual encounter with, you know, many years ago. And in a time when such things were quite common, it was all safe sex, you know. but basically, it was about somebody I met a long time ago and had this like really great wild time with, and then really never saw again. But I got a letter from her, and because of this letter, I feel like I know all kinds of things about her that I wouldn't have known otherwise. I remember it vividly, but I didn't know a thing about her. So like to get a letter from somebody 40 years later was really great. And so I actually began writing this song, talking to this, not only to this person from my past, but talking to that time. If you write something that's primarily nostalgic in its tone, you have to have a reason for going there. And I think, like I say in this song, you know, I want to go down singing, you know, and giving that heaven away. The real issue is really about the freedoms. I look around for the 60s sound, but those days are gone, you know, and all us acid dropping, world stopping, bebop and freaks are just hanging on. It's really, I really don't mind the role of being this, you know, like sort of, you know, unrepentant, wild, you know, spirit. And it's one song that people would just start singing before it even gets to the end of the song. People would be singing along with it, just giving that heaven away. Well, where were you? At one point I was going to call it In Harm's Way, because that's the line from the song, you know, but I think the refrain, where were you, is so incessant and so insistent that I decided to call it that. But as we started to work on the song, it really became about Katrina, because really the subject of why there are people living in the streets is just as compelling as the subject, where would they go? It's a really emotional song for me to sing. It was an attempt to pare down a very large subject as something that was sort of listenable and expressible. In the end, I didn't even know how to end the song. And I saw this photograph that Bruce Weber had taken. It was part of the W Magazine spread on post-Katrina New Orleans. There was this great banner and it was a flag that somebody had sewn, and it said, "If ever I cease to love." I realized that was, after all this exhaustive reading and all this, that really is the question. It's like, how, you know, what will become of us if you don't love your country enough or love humanity enough to prevent this kind of thing from happening. The Cuba song may be my favorite thing on the record. It's an embrace of the Cuban people and a kind of defiance, you know, against what I think is kind of like a really very dated and oddly sort of Soviet policy. It's really weird to tell Americans that they can't go someplace, especially if that serves a kind of propaganda mill that tries to demonize these people. And because they don't have TV, or the TV is so bad, evidently, that nobody watches it, they're the most burning musicians you've ever heard. I mean, it's like a whole island full of just the most incredible players. So anyway, this song is an embrace and a sort of defiance of like of our policy, and by defiance I mean in the most friendly terms. On Far From the Arms of Hunger, again is a piece of music that I had for a while, and I had this first line, and I didn't know how to say it. I didn't know how to say what I was feeling. I didn't even know how to identify what I was feeling. I would play these changes, and there would be this line, "Far from the arms of hunger." It turns out to be more or less an expression of a hope. It's almost like a prayer, expression of a very, very strongly held desire for a world that we don't have at present. we've always had war and there will always be war. That's really what I, you know. And we grew up with this idea that if the world is the way it is, you're not going to change it. This is human nature. There will always be people killing one another. I know the tendency to enslave one another is really very strong. The impulse to kill, the impulse to destroy, you know, is very strong in the human spirit. But I think that's a struggle we're in. And that's one that we can't afford to give up on. Across the drifting sand, you know, the joining of our hands in time. This slowest of all songs. This is the most slow and hypnotic sort of, you know, statement of this idea. And yet, just by nature of what I'm saying in the song, I think there's an urgency behind it, because I don't think we have forever. Time the Conqueror concerns a dream that I had, or possibly I'm still having. It was about my childhood. It was about being a child on the street that I lived on. Or maybe it was not about being a child on the street that I lived on. It was maybe about just being on the street that I was a child on. So, but it, I kind of use a lot of images and thoughts from my whole life, so that it sort of kaleidoscopes, especially at the end, sort of a kaleidoscopic picture of different moments in time and the various things that are at issue. Even at this late date, on the last verse, at this point in my life, I'm still trying to, you know, decide what kind of world I believe in, you know, a world that's open and opening up, and its beginning is unfolding, or one that is, you know, nearing its end. And I think that's, you know, you could look at it as a metaphor for just the subject of mortality and where I am in my life. But it's, I think it's an ongoing question that you can have at any time in your life. So time will heal all wounds, which of course you hear your whole life, you know, time heals all wounds. But time will steal you blind, time the wheel, time the conqueror.